There's no doubt that the SCP Foundation has come across some dangerous anomalies over the years. If you had to guess, what would you say is the most dangerous SCP they have in containment? A lot of people might immediately think of SCP-682, the hard-to-destroy reptile. And perhaps they might be right. After all, we're talking about a gigantic lizard that can regenerate almost all forms of damage, and harbors a burning hatred for any and all other forms of life. Then there's the various eldritch entities the Foundation has come into contact with, beings that could easily rewrite all of reality out of pure anger, or just to torment us for their own amusement. But the most dangerous SCP might well be something completely unassuming. Instead of a zombie-producing plague doctor, or an actual plague of flesh-eating zombies, imagine if there was just a man. One seemingly ordinary human man. Nothing about him that looks unusual, no mimetic or anomalous superpower. And yet one look at him tells you that he's the most dangerous man you've ever seen. Someone who should be locked up forever for all the horrible things he's done. Welcome to the story of Frasier Melbrook, the most dangerous person, also known as SCP-3017. To anyone that knew him, Frasier was just an ordinary man. Although at 25 years of age, he had not exactly lived a charmed life. People would look at him and could almost tell there was something unsavory about Frasier's character. It was as if one glance could somehow tell you that he was trouble. It was this unshakable feeling that he gave people that led to Frasier Melbrook being arrested, and arrested, and arrested some more. Over the course of his adult life, he was placed under arrest a total of 23 times. Frasier was suspected of having committed a number of different crimes, ranging from robbery and assault all the way up to accusations of murder. Interestingly, he was never formally indicted for any of his alleged crimes, meaning he was only ever arrested and held as a suspect, but never once was he confirmed to have been guilty. There was never any evidence, nothing to prove beyond reasonable doubt that Frasier was, in fact, a criminal. Instead, every arrest boiled down to the way he made people in his presence feel. Unfortunately, even though he was never proven to be guilty, or even capable of committing the crimes he was accused of, Frasier Melbrook's multiple arrests garnered him a notable criminal record, and soon drew the attention of the SCP Foundation. When he was transferred into Foundation containment and designated as SCP-3017, it was believed that Frasier had some form of connection to a number of groups of interest. These are various organizations that the Foundation monitors, viewing them as causes for concern and sometimes outright threats. This list includes the Church of the Broken God, a cult of religious zealots that worship an entity that combines a number of SCPs, as well as the Global Occult Coalition, a gung-ho organization policing the paranormal that shares an uneasy history with the Foundation. However, no member of staff could explain exactly why they thought Frasier Melbrook had any connection to these groups. There was no evidence that he was, but still, they had a hunch. And so, testing began. Hours upon hours of rigorous interviews and experimentation, trying to understand what it was that made people want to keep this seemingly ordinary man locked up. After extensive research was conducted by Foundation personnel, they were able to determine why SCP-3017 had been arrested so many times before, and what had drawn the Foundation to him in the first place. Frasier Melbrook was suffering from a cognitohazard. This was a condition that did not so much have a direct adverse effect on him, but rather influenced those around him. Anyone that stood close enough to SCP-3017 or made an attempt to engage him directly in conversation, even those that just looked at him, all reacted the same way. Frasier gave people the overwhelming belief that he needed to be placed in custody, even if he'd not said or done anything to give them a reason to. Anyone that looked at, spoke to, or even stood near him became spontaneously aware that SCP-3017 was some sort of dangerous criminal. The cognitohazard didn't give people knowledge of his exact crimes. It more just made them believe that Frasier had a violent disposition and that he needed to be locked away. Any person staying within the vicinity of SCP-3017 for an hour or longer would experience further effects of Frasier's cognitohazard. Beyond just knowing there was something untowards about him, those who spent extended time around SCP-3017 would actively try to restrain him, and then after an hour, they would exhibit violent behavior towards him. They would start obsessively trying to ensure that he was incarcerated, almost like the thought of him being free was so horrifying that they couldn't help but try to arrest him themselves. Luckily, these effects of longer exposure to Frasier were not permanent, and often the subject's tendencies to try to restrain him could be cured through amnestics. The effects of Frasier Melbrook's cognitohazardous condition seemed to change relative to the amount of time he remained incarcerated. After continuous exposure to SCP-3017, the effects of his cognitohazard would appear to fade, meaning that those who had previously been compelled to incarcerate him would later become indifferent, or even release him freely. This caused a problem for the Foundation and raised a very important question. How do you contain someone that you later feel the urge to set free? The answer was designated SCP-3017-1, a list of individuals with a connection to Frasier Melbrook, all of whom had seemingly become immune to the outward effects of his condition. Not one of these people could be convinced that Frasier was a violent criminal that everyone else saw. Among the list of names were Frasier's parents, Vivian and Beck, along with his siblings, grandmother, former classmates, and romantic partners, and his fiancée, Nadia. But you might be wondering, how did the SCP Foundation use nothing more than a list of names to keep SCP-3017 caged? By threatening them, of course. Researchers who interviewed Frasier found that they could greatly decrease the secondary effect of his condition, making them far less compelled to free him. All it took was them to tell Frasier that his family, friends, fiancé would be captured, tortured, or even killed if he tried to escape containment. According to the Foundation, this didn't stop Frasier from trying to escape, though. His file states that he actively made several attempts to breach containment, all of which failed. The truth, however, was that just about any move that Frasier made was misinterpreted as an attempted escape. In one instance, while trying just to use the bathroom, SCP-3017 was tackled and restrained by a Foundation guard. You see, Frasier knew that just like with his previous arrests, he'd done nothing to deserve being locked up and interrogated by the SCP Foundation. But to the eyes of everyone around him, he was a dangerous threat. The researchers and guards treated him like a monster, because as far as they saw, he was one. By manipulating information about the current health of his loved ones, like telling him his grandmother had developed lung cancer, the Foundation kept Frasier under lock and key. Hearing threats against his friends and family, or bad news about their current state, quickly put an end to SCP-3017's attempts at escape. Even though he was frustrated with the Foundation, he was without hope and had little choice in the matter. So Frasier did his best to comply with his captors and offer the SCP Foundation information on groups of interest he thought they wanted to hear, even though he had no affiliation with any of them. By bringing Frasier's fiancée, Nadia, into containment and showing him a live video feed of her, Foundation researcher Dr. Kiran hoped to coax a wealth of valuable information out of SCP-3017. Afraid for his partner's life, Frasier did his best to answer their questions, and Nadia was later freed and given amnestics to forget the incident. But Foundation researcher Rylan was quick to realize that the information Dr. Kiran had extracted from SCP-3017 didn't seem to add up. Frasier, of course, had no knowledge about any groups of interest, and had to improvise to protect his fiancé. Researcher Rylan picked up on this, remarking that SCP-3017's information could not be considered reliable, but she was unsure if Frasier was hiding something or simply didn't know anything. During another interrogation, Frasier's brother, a former classmate, and two former romantic partners were brought into the Foundation and sedated. In an adjacent room, Frasier was threatened by Dr. Kiran with a handgun and made sure to answer further questions. Every time he didn't, the doctor threatened to shoot one of Frasier's loved ones. It was after this incident that researcher Rylan once again reassessed the information given by SCP-3017. Finally, she came to realize that there was no evidence of Frasier's criminal history, nor was there anything tying him to groups of interest. Everything that the Foundation had thought of him was just a result of SCP-3017's condition, and he genuinely had none of the information they'd been seeking. He was only answering their questions to protect the lives of people he cared for. Realizing the huge ethical mistake the Foundation had made, essentially psychologically torturing Frazier for information he simply didn't have, researcher Ryland begged her superiors that SCP-3017 be released. The request was denied, and instead Ryland was contained, believed to be a new instance of SCP-3017-1. With the help of security officer Rudolf Cardiad, who had guarded Frazier, Ryland escaped her own cell and the pair of them triggered a containment alarm. In the ensuing confusion, Ryland and Cardiad freed SCP-3017 from his incarceration, and she and Frazier escaped the containment facility where Officer Cardiad was captured and contained by security personnel. Ryland brought Frazier to what she thought was safety of his family's home, but neither of them expected to see what awaited them. The house had been burned to the ground, with almost all of Frazier's family inside. His parents, siblings, grandmother, fiancé, and even neighbor had all perished in a fire that had engulfed the one place in the world that Frazier hadn't been held against his will. It is still unclear if the fire was intentionally started by a member of the SCP Foundation to drive SCP-3017 back into containment, or had merely been an unfortunate accident. But notably, Dr. Kiron had been strangely absent during SCP-3017 and Ryland's escape from the Foundation. Overwhelmed with grief and despair, Frazier was last seen on a bridge not far from his childhood home, and researcher Ryland was recaptured without resistance by Foundation personnel near the same spot. With SCP-3017 gone, along with his cognitohazardous effects, both her and Security Officer Cardiad were reinstated back to full employment with the Foundation. The Foundation then reclassified SCP-3017 as neutralized, quietly avoiding the truth of their mistake. All records of his supposed criminal activity and links to anomalous groups were stricken from the record as unsubstantiated. He had been innocent all along, just a man who had never done anything he was accused of and didn't deserve to be locked away. The SCP Foundation had tortured Frazier, asking him questions he didn't have the answers to, using the love he had for those closest to him as a way to try and goad him into giving the Foundation what they wanted, and in the end, may have been responsible for multiple innocent people being murdered. Perhaps it was easier for them to stamp neutralized on his file than to actually face up what they'd done to him. The Foundation has spent at least a century containing anomalies and monsters, but the hardest monsters to contain are often the ones that emerge within us. And nothing better illustrates that than the Foundation's monstrous treatment of SCP-3017. Now check out SCP-5094 Miss J's WizKid Schoolhouse and SCP-507 Reluctant Dimension Hopper for more SCP Foundation stories that'll tug at your heartstrings.